pleasure for me to introduce Ilan Pappé. I first heard his voice from the sky, namely from the radio, without knowing who he was, and I was immediately impressed by the clarity of his vision and the calmness and the soundness of what he said. Afterwards, I had the pleasure of listening to him live and reading a few of his books, but anyhow, and they are very good, I must say. Even the last one is a must read, in my opinion. Anyhow, he is, of course, a historian and an activist. Difficult to say what he is most, so I would call him a public intellectual in the tradition of Said, saying the truth to power. I think that's something I would love to come back to. His most famous book, he has 20, so I will not bore you with the full list. It is, maybe not the full list, on Wikipedia English. There's 18 on Wikipedia, but the last one is not in it, so I think it's at least 19, but maybe it's more than 20. But the most famous or infamous is, of course, the ethnic cleansing of Palestine, the ethnic cleansing of Palestina, on sale in this audience in after the talk in Dutch. And this one also is on sale after the talk. The 10 myths, let's say the topic of tonight, 10 myths of Israel. Very, very good book, I must say. I'm just finishing. But a book that I also would advise, especially to an academic audience, is Out of the Frame, The Struggle for Academic Freedom in Israel. The subtitle says it all. A very interesting account of the difficulty of saying certain things inside Israel, and in fact also with the story how an Israeli-born intellectual was moved out of his own country for saying the wrong things. Voilà. I hope we can come back on this task of the public intellectual. I think that's a very topical theme. Talking of topical, of course, having Ilan Pappé talking about the 10 myths of Israel is, as somebody said, of a burning topicality, as 52 people died today. But without further ado, I give you the floor.
Great pleasure to be here. I want to thank the organizers for making the effort and bringing me to your lovely town and to this university. And as was mentioned by Lord, this is a very difficult time to talk about Palestine in a historical perspective, as I will do, because this is what I was asked to do, while so many terrible things are happening as we speak, actually. Not only 52 Palestinians were killed, another 40 are in critical condition, probably will not make it, and more than 1,000 have been wounded today, and all by direct fire by the Israeli army into a group of unarmed Palestinian demonstrators. And what is as worse as the crime itself is the total silence in the EU, in Europe, in this country too. Very few people remark about it. The local media here sees both sides. I don't know how you can see both sides between a murderer and those who are assassinated. There are no two sides in murder. There is a murder and there is the victim of the murder. But this is the nature of the coverage of the events in Palestine today, and it's no different from the way Palestine has been covered in this country and in the rest of the continent in the last 70 years since the inception of the Jewish state. But I would put aside for a moment the horrific events that are happening as we speak here today on the border of Gaza, but I will be very happy also to return to them in the questions, and I don't think that my talk is entirely disassociated from the reality today on the ground, because in Palestine, history and the present are the same time. the same period of time. I wrote this rather small book, as you can see, the 10 Myths of Israel, for several reasons, and I think these reasons are also connected to what I just mentioned about the massacre in Gaza today and the way it is being portrayed and covered in the local media here and in Europe altogether. The first reason was that I felt that there was a gap among the people who were engaged with the Palestine question between the academics and the activists. A lot of activists worked on commitment, a sense of injustice, and motivated by a justified fury about what was going on in Palestine. You don't hear it?
No.
Oh, sorry.
So maybe we should or take this one?
Maybe I'll take this
yes.
one.
Yes.
Okay.
Or can
I Okay.
Better?
I feel like in the Inquisition. Yeah. Confess all my sins to the Zionist state. No, this is better. Can you hear me now in the back? Do I have to repeat everything or is it? Thank God for that. Okay, so I'll continue. The first reason I wrote the book, I felt that a lot of activists don't have enough time or maybe motivation to know and to educate themselves about the history of Palestine and what goes on in Palestine. And I thought that activists needed more information, more knowledge. A lot of academics who work in Palestine were not activists enough. So I thought the book kind of bridges between these two communities. The activists should know more, and those who know should be more active. If you read the book, you can see that this is a model that tries to, at least I try to propose a model that, as you rightly said, if you want a public intellectual, or at least the activist, the scholar, or the scholar as an activist. The second reason I wrote the book, I felt that the Israeli propaganda was based on certain mythos, or mythologies, and not always those who were defending the rights of the Palestinians in the Palestinian cause knew exactly how to challenge this propaganda. And you can't always challenge what could be quite a sophisticated propaganda by just a sense of justice, by saying, I know I'm right and you're wrong. Knowledge is an important tool for showing the audiences that this, that most of what the Israelis are claiming about the Palestinians and is accepted by many people in the world are really lies, are fabrications. So what I did, I took 10 such major points and I compared them to the research, the update research on Palestine, to show that actually academic works show that most of the Israeli claims with regard to Palestine are baseless, and that updated research shows that they are fabrications of history or manipulation of history. And the final reason I did it, and maybe this was the most important reason, is that the so-called peace process between Israel and Palestine, which was mainly an American project, that began more or less after the June 67 war, kind of 50 years of a futile diplomatic attempt to solve the problem. This process was built on an American assumption that history is an obstacle for peace. If you read the biographies and autobiographies of the Americans who were involved in the peace process, the diplomats, the Secretary of State, the academics, you can see that they have something in common. They say that the problem with the Palestinians is that they are stuck in history and they refuse to look at the present and towards the future. What was amazing about this assumption that the Palestinians were not helping with peace because they are thinking about what happened 50 or 60 or 70 years ago, that from an American point of view, there was never a problem with the Zionist historical memory that went 2,000 years ago. So it was okay to bring claims on the basis of something that happened 2,000 years ago, but it was not constructive to bring a history that happened 50 or 60 years ago. In fact, what I claim in this book is that in order to understand the essence of the conflict in Palestine, in order to think in a positive way of how to solve it, you need to go back to the history of the conflict. History is not an obstacle. History is a necessary means to find peace and reconciliation in the land of Palestine. The myths are very important because the Israeli, although the Israeli point of view is not as popular and solid as it used to be, let's say 30 years ago, and there is a significant shift in the world public opinion about Palestine that is positive, and there is more recognition of the Palestinian point of view, and people are much more familiar with the concerns and aspirations of the Palestinians, and I think know better about the Israelis' aspirations and visions. And yet, I think too many people still do not know enough about that history, or do not understand that history. In fact, I have a bold assumption that the vast majority of the Europeans and Americans, including the Norwegians who did the Oslo Accord, and all the Americans who were involved in the peace process, have little knowledge about what happened in Palestine in 1948, and even know less about the significance of what happened in 1948 to the present reality. And I'm thinking also of people with good intention who wanted to really help the Palestinians and Israelis. I think they're very ignorant. For example, I read a few of the things that President Obama wrote about the question of Palestine. That he wouldn't pass a course in a university with such a paper. It was full of mistakes, it was full of illogical assumptions about Palestine, and this is an intelligent president, unlike the one that is running America today. And such a level, and then you read him about the African-American problem, you read him about Latin America, you read him about Vietnam. Very knowledgeable, very impressive. You really thought at the time, this is the president who is educated, intellectual, and knows. But when he talks about Palestine, it's unbelievable how primitive it is. And then you go to European philosophers, from Jacques Derrida through Bernard Lévy and other philosophers, and you read them on every issue in the world, and you say, whether you agree with them or not, you say, they made an effort to know, they educated themselves, you can agree or disagree with their final conclusions, but you don't feel that they don't know what they're talking about. And then you read them on Palestine, and you say, I don't believe it's the same person. No respect for universal values, no interest in humanity. They all talk like little diplomats in the Israeli embassy. And I think part of what I wanted to do in the book is to say, these are the 10 myths that people who are philosophers, policy makers, diplomats, are basing their position towards the Palestine question without an attempt to learn, to educate, to listen, or to even visit the place and understand what goes on. So I thought I would prepare for them a short book, so that they could not claim that the book was too long, and before that, because of that, They don't know. Now they have no excuse. The book is in 15 languages. They all should be able to say at least that they know. And then let's see their moral position vis-a-vis the reality. The reason, an additional reason that history is very important, and in a moment I will go to the myths themselves, because I think some of them are familiar to you, some of them may be less familiar to you. The other reason that history is so important is actually elaborated in the book in one of the historical myths, is because I think there is either a genuine or a cynical misunderstanding of the nature of the Zionist project in Palestine. If you read well-meaning books by scholars in the West about the Israel-Palestine conflict, or if you read university program, what we call curriculum, a program for teaching in university courses on the Israeli-Palestinian issue, you can see that most of the scholarship frames the conflict as a conflict between two national movements. Both of them have a claim to the same land. So peace is really how to reconcile these two claims. The most sensible way of satisfying these claim is by offering to partition the land, to give half of the land to one side, to give the other half to the second side, and if someone refuses to accept this sensible idea of dividing the land into two states, for instance, it means that that particular side is responsible for the conflict and its continuation. The fact that in the case of Palestine, the Palestinians were never offered even half of Palestine, not in 1947, and definitely not after 1967, is beside the point. But this is the whole idea. And actually, this kind of idea of a balance, of a parity, and someone just showed me the statement of the Ministry of Foreign, the EU Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Morghini. The Italian foreign minister. I cannot pronounce the name now. I'm so angry with her that I cannot pronounce it. She, her statement about Gaza is that both sides should show restraint. What kind of restraint can peaceful demonstrations show in front of the firing squad of the Israeli army? What does she mean that the Palestinian side should show restraint? I don't think she even thought of what she wrote down. That's what you do in the EU. You say both sides are to blame, both sides are responsible, both sides should behave well, and so on. The research on Palestine, the academic research on Palestine, has moved much further than the diplomats in understanding that this whole idea that there is a conflict in Palestine between two national movements has nothing to do with the reality on the ground. There is no conflict between two national movements in Palestine. The Zionist movement is a settler colonial movement. It's not the only one in the world. Quite many places in the world, Europeans who were persecuted in Europe were looking for a safe place. Not all of them were Jews, and not all of them left Europe in the late 19th century as the Zionists. They left Europe in different centuries. They were usually victims of religious persecution, sometimes economic persecution, and they were looking for a new homeland. And they usually needed the help of an empire to get to a new place outside of Europe, but very soon after they got to the place, they wanted to disassociate themselves from the empire. And that's when they started to think about themselves as a different national group than the European, from the European places that they came from. For example, the settlers who came to North America needed the British Empire to get to North America, but regarded themselves as a different national group, and eventually went on a war of independence against the empire that brought them there, the British Empire, right? This is 1776. Similar thing happened in South Africa. The Boers had a war of independence against the British Empire in the late 19th century. And the same happened in Palestine. The Zionist movement that needed the British Empire to build a colony in Palestine eventually fought a war of independence, which the Israeli called a war of independence, against the British Empire. In fact, that's what the Israeli celebrate this week, the Day of Independence, or last month, the Day of Independence, is independence from Britain, not independence from the Palestinians. It's independence from Britain. So that's typical for settler colonialist movements. What is also typical to settler colonialist movements is that the main problem was not so much the relationship with the empire. That was not the problem that they could solve. The main problem was that usually they chose a place where already someone else lived. And when the settlers met the natives, when the settler met the indigenous population, usually, and unfortunately, it ended with the elimination of the natives. In the United States, in Canada, it ended in pure genocide, genocide of the Native Americans, genocide of the First Nations in Canada. It ended in genocide in Australia of the Aboriginals, almost a more partial genocide in New Zealand. In places like Palestine and South Africa, the result of this impulse of the settlers to get rid of the native population ended in South Africa in an apartheid system that was institutionalized in 1948. And interestingly enough, it ended in Palestine in the ethnic cleansing of the Palestinians also in 1948. So actually what the research tells us, that what you have in Palestine is not a conflict between two national movements. You have a conflict between settlers, a settler colonialist movement, and a native population, indigenous population. And that the main object of the settler colonial movement, the Zionist settler colonial movement, is not different from the main ambition of the settler colonialist movement in the United States at the time, or in Australia, or in other parts in the world where settlers decided that they need a new home and a new homeland at the expense of the local population. That it's a conflict between the ambition of the settler colonialist movement to have as much of the homeland, of the new homeland as possible, with as few of the natives as possible. And if you, as I try to show in the book and other books of mine, if you read the thoughts and writing of the Zionists from the very beginning of the Zionist project, and if you look at the policies of the Zionist movement in Palestine, this is the main direction of the thinking, and this is the main orientation of the actions. They are meant to create a Jewish Palestine instead of an Arab Palestine. And all the means were justified. In 1948, the Zionist movement had an historical opportunity to implement this vision of emptying the land from its indigenous people and replacing them by Jewish settlers. They had an historical opportunity. I don't have time to go into the reasons why in 48, but I think many of you know that in 48, Britain decided to leave Palestine. It was 3 years after the Holocaust. The world was very lenient towards Jewish crime against the Palestinians. The Arab world had its own liberation wars. So 48 was a very good opportunity to implement almost in full this logic of the settler colonialist movement. That is the logic of what Patrick Moore, who was a great scholar of settler colonialism, called the logic of the elimination of the native. Now, elimination is not always genocide. And what really is, and I try to show it through the 10 myths, that what you really see is that the means for getting rid of the Palestinians change with time, but not the object. In 1948, Israel expelled half of the Palestinian population, destroyed half of the Palestinian villages, ruined almost all the Palestinian towns within 9 months, between February 1948 to October, 7 months actually, between February to the end of October 1948. Within 7 months, Palestine disappeared. And the Palestinians disappeared in great numbers from Palestine. But the problem of a settler colonialist movement is that the project does not end until it is completed. And half of the Palestinians remain in Palestine. And not all of Palestine was directly controlled by Israel. And then that is why settler colonialism is not an event. It doesn't happen in one date. It's a structure. It's an historical structure. It continues to this very day. The same ideology that was behind the Nakba, the Palestinian catastrophe in 1948, is the same ideology that informs the young Israeli soldiers who are today shooting and killing Palestinian children, men, on the border of Gaza. It's the same ideology. Because settler colonialism also dehumanizes the native. You cannot massively kill people, and you cannot massively expel them if you regard them as human beings like yours. You have to dehumanize them first. They have to look to you not like you, and then even a baby could be regarded as a terrorist, and even a child can be regarded as the enemy. And I think this is the main myth that is important, that sort of includes all the 10 myths together, because I don't have time to go through the 10 myths. The main myth is that there is a conflict in Palestine between two national movements. It's not true. And that it's even less true that one of the sides is more democratic, more reasonable, more Western, more European, and therefore it's not responsible for the lack of peace. It's the other side, the Arabs. The Muslims, you know, they are not rational people. And therefore, they keep rejecting generous Israeli offers of peace. No, this is not a peace that is offered to two sides. This is an attempt by an ideological movement that became an ideological state to persuade the indigenous native population to say, you know what, okay, you colonize us, you can continue to colonize us, and we will say that you are legitimate. If anybody wants to understand why even Abu Mazen, who is not the most impressive and strongest Palestinian leader, but why even Abu Mazen refuses to recognize Israel as a Jewish state, and he will never recognize Israel as a Jewish state. If you want to understand why even he cannot recognize Israel as a Jewish state, you have to understand that he, as a Palestinian, and every Palestinian, understands that if you recognize Israel as a Jewish state, you say, as the victim of a racist state, I, as the victim of your racism, accept and legitimize your racist state. He can, of course, accept Israel as a fact. What can he do? And he could say, I could create a Palestinian state next to your state. But not one Palestinian would say, thank you for expelling us, thank you for dispossessing us, thank you for colonizing us. Thank you for taking our life away from us. It's like asking the Africans in apartheid South Africa to recognize, to tell the world, we have no problem with being Africans in an apartheid system. It's unreasonable. But try to talk to diplomats, journalists, academics in the West about this. Tell them, they would say, no, he's not reasonable, Abu Mazen, if he doesn't recognize Israel as a Jewish state. Why can't the Palestinians recognize Israel as a Jewish state? And they say it because they're really ignorant. Doesn't matter whether they're presidents or prime ministers or foreign ministers of the EU. They are really ignorant, or they don't bother to understand what is the reality on the ground. And the whole peace process, which is one of the myths I'm dealing with in the book, was based on this misunderstanding. Now, I'm not saying that people misunderstood it on purpose. Maybe some of them really were not clever enough to understand it. Others didn't want to bother, maybe understood what it was about and could not accept it. Let me now focus a little bit of the myths and their nature before I end my talk. I divide the book into the myths of the past, the myths of the present, and the myths about the future. So let me choose from each period one myth, and by that I will end and hopefully open it for you. The most annoying myth of the past you probably are familiar with is this idea that Palestine was a land without people, waiting for a people without land. I show that the research shows clearly that Palestine was not empty, that the Palestinians were a normal people of this part of the Arab world that were modernized, were developing their own national identity, and that Zionism came at the moment that actually Palestine was about to move into the modern era with national ideology, with everything that went with the modern society, but this was stopped by the Zionist colonization. I'm less interested in the question whether the Jews were people without land. I know some Israeli scholars and are interested in it. I'm less interested in this part. I don't care if people want to think that they belong to people who lived 2,000 years ago in Palestine. They have the right to think that way. The problem is not whether this myth is correct or not. The problem is, what do you do with this mythology? If in the name of this idea that you live somewhere 2,000 years ago, you have the right to dispossess those who live there now, then the myth is problematic. I don't care whether you can prove, I don't think you can prove, that I am a descendant of King David. I don't even like him that much, so I'm not sure. But let's say I like the prophet Amos. I hope I belong to him. I like the prophet Amos. I would not go to a clinic and ask to take a hair of nine to show whether I am the descendant of and definitely I would not use this family connection to dispossess the Palestinians. But this is the basic of Zionism. Very secular Jews, Jews who didn't like Jewish religion, one should say. Zionism was a very secular movement. They wanted to get away from the Jewish religion, but used the Bible as the proof for their right to Palestine. As I said once, Zionist is a group of Jews who do not believe in God, but they believe that God promised them Palestine. This is the nature of Zionism. It's a very secular movement uses the Bible. By the way, they're not the only ones. Christians use the Bible as well to do the Crusades, and they use the Christianity to colonize people, to genocide them. Nothing is exceptional here about the Jewish behavior in Palestine. What is exceptional is that it still goes today, and it's legitimized by the international community. That's what is exceptional. That the international community says, there was a racist state, ethnic racist state created in 1948 that claims to be the only democracy in the Middle East. And we all know that there isn't such a thing as Jewish democracy, as there isn't such a thing as a Christian democracy, or a Muslim democracy, or a Buddhist democracy. But in the case of Israel, we accept that this democracy can work, although all the evidence show that it never worked, it doesn't work, and will not work. But there is an international legitimacy because of Islamophobia, because of the guilt complex in Europe about the Holocaust, because of the Israeli lobby in the United States. There are various reasons which I try to cover in the book why this legitimacy continues. So this is about the past. The present, I think the most important myth about the present is that it is about the peace process. That it is if there was a genuine chance for peace during the time of the Oslo period, the Oslo process. I was invited in 2013 to commemorate 20 years to Oslo by the Institute for Peace, FAFO, who were the orchestrators and architects of Oslo. And I was surprised to hear in 2013 the president or chair, I don't remember, of this organization proudly said, we in FAFO Baku are very proud of the Oslo process. And we want to send this model of peace to other places where there are conflicts. I said to him, are you sure I'm not going to buy a car from you? Let alone a peace process from you. You created the worst kind of peace process, where life of people became much worse after the peace process than they were before the peace process. How can you be proud of producing something that turned out to be an umbrella for Israel to continue the occupation of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, but allowing Europe to pay for the occupation and making the world thinking that this is part of the peace process and not part of colonization and oppression? And I think this is an important myth that we should refute, as if we were all involved in a peace process between 1993 until 2000, when supposedly the peace process collapsed. This was not a peace process. This was a successful Israeli attempt to make the occupation cheaper and to make it seem like, had it not been for the Palestinian stubbornness, the so-called occupation would have ended. I also claim in this book that we shouldn't use the term occupation. Occupations don't go on for 50 years. Occupation go on for 3 years, for 4 years. This is not an occupation. It's a colonization. We should call it what it is. It's very difficult for people to accept colonization as a term in the 21st century. And here I come, and with this I end, for the myth about the future. Because it's not a conflict between two national movements, and because it's a conflict between a colonialism, a special kind of colonialism, settler colonialism, and the native people of Palestine, because this is the nature of the conflict, what we need is not a peace process. We don't need the two sides to sit together and decide how much of Palestine belongs to the settlers and how much of Palestine belongs to the native people. How much of the water belongs to the Jews and how much of the water belongs to the Palestinians, and where would be the border? This will not at all end the oppression and the suffering of the Palestinians and also the Israelis that suffer, because the Palestinians did establish an anti-colonialist movement that is using also violence in order to try and achieve its objectives. So if you want to remove the violence, you need to go to the source of the violence. And the source of the violence is the idea that a settler movement of Jews has the right to colonize someone else's land. So what we need is not a peace process. What we need is decolonization. And we need to decolonize Israel. We need to decolonize Palestine. And we have to adopt this idea of decolonization to the 21st century. Decolonization in the 19th century or 20th century is different from decolonization today. Decolonization today is far more attached to human rights and civil rights, especially the Palestinian right of return, of refugees to return. And I think, and with this I would end, that people sometimes outside of Palestine and the Arab world, I don't like the term the Middle East. This is a colonialist term, the Middle East. Middle of war, east of war. Nobody in the Middle East says, I'm from the Middle East. Only the people in Europe say, you are from the Middle East. Well, they're not from the Middle East. They're from the Arab world. What do you mean the Middle East? Anyway, coming back to the main point that I wanted to make. People outside the Arab world do not understand the connection between the way Israel and Palestine was treated and the other kind of horrible things that we see that are happening today in Yemen, in Syria, in Libya, and other places. This is a very bad moment for the Arab world, no doubt about it. And the main issue in the Arab world is human rights, the abuse of human rights, both by regimes and by opposition groups. Nobody is an angel in the story of Syria, nobody is an angel in the story of Iraq, and other places in the Arab world. And in order to have a proper conversation about human rights, when you are embroiled with so much blood, what you need is international solidarity, not international intervention like the Americans are doing. But you need help from the outside. Sometimes you are so embroiled in abuses of human rights that it happened to Europe as well. Europe needed the international help. Now, if you want to have a proper international engagement with France, in Syria, in Iraq, and elsewhere in the Arab world. You have to gain the confidence of people that you really mean to help with human rights. And you have to start where human rights have been abused in the last 100 years and nobody paid attention, in Palestine. The abuses in the Arab world started long after they were already intact in Palestine. So if you want to have a genuine conversation, don't make Israel an exception. Say to the Israelis, you and everyone else who abuses human rights in the Arab world will not be accepted as legitimate person, state, or organization in a civilized world. This should be the message. And the moment you include Israel in this, and in the moment you include the Palestinians in Gaza as victims of barbarism and humanity as much as you include everyone else that people do, you will begin to have a proper conversation about human rights and civil rights also in the rest of the Arab world. And I think this is the message also the Israelis need to know. And talking about one of the myths in Israel is that the Israelis, as you know, it's typical to settlers. They don't like usually the country they came to. What they really want, and one can understand it, almost you can sympathize with this. They want the whole country to be in their country. You can see how settlers to America brought all the vegetation from Europe and ruined the ecosystem. I mean, in America, what the settlers did to the water, they brought fish from Croatia because they wanted to continue to eat the fish that they ate in Croatia, destroyed the whole ecosystem in California. I won't go into it. But the Zionists were typical settlers in this way. They wanted Palestine to be part of Europe. But Palestine is part of the Arab world. It's not part of Europe. And the Israelis can win the Eurovision, but Palestine will remain in the Arab world. The Israelis can dream that there will be an earthquake that will take Palestine and put it in Germany, but it will remain in the Arab world. It won't help them. And they will have to come to terms with the fact that they are in the Arab world. They are part of its problems. They are part of its solutions. They cannot continue to see themselves as the main base for civilization, Western culture. This is such a racist idea that really creates problems for the people in the Arab world and does not help them to get out of the serious problems that they have. So let me finish by saying the following. I think that we need to know the history of Palestine. We also need to know that the catastrophe, what we call the Nakba, which we commemorate tomorrow, the 15th of May, that the catastrophe that happened in 1948 has not finished in 1948. The ethnic cleansing of Palestine has continued from 1948 and continues until today. Every day, someone in Palestine is being expelled, their house being demolished, and they suffer from an ethnic cleansing. And it's important to understand that this is going on, as the Palestinians call it, it's a Nakba Mustamira, the ongoing Nakba, the ongoing catastrophe, which is typical to a settler colonial movement. They cannot rest as long as this is their mindset, as long as this is their ideology. They cannot rest until they complete the project of turning the whole of Palestine into a space in which Palestinians do not exist anymore. Now, they will not succeed. It's very clear. You cannot do it in the 21st century. And if they will not succeed, it means that if they will continue to try and attempt, they will continue to create bloodshed and conflict. Now, I'm not saying that the Palestinians have any chance of winning in the long, in the short term or maybe in the midterm. What I'm saying is that the world, and I hope the world is beginning, at least in the civil society, not in the political elites, beginning to understand much better the reality on the ground. And the Israelis are risking of losing their legitimacy in the world. And therefore, one of the myths, I conclude the book, where I also talk about the book, is that anti-Zionism, criticism of Israel, is not anti-Semitism. It actually is a humanist position that says Zionism is bad for Palestinians, Zionism is bad for Jews, Zionism is bad for Christians, Zionism is a racist ideology that justifies the ongoing Nakba of the Palestinians. And we object it because we object racism. We are against racism against Muslims, against Jews, against Christians, against anyone. That's racism. Racism is generic. There isn't a specific racism which is worse than another racism. Every racism is bad. And the fact that people can shut up voices of criticism in Belgium by telling people, oh, you're anti-Semites because you criticize Israel, because you declare that Zionism is a racist ideology. The fact that it works is an insult to our intelligence. Really, it's an insult to our intelligence. To say, especially if you are a knowledgeable person, if you read my book or any other book, and you say, if you know what Zionism stands for, if you know what Zionist movement did in Palestine, and you say, these were crimes against human beings, whose only crime was that they were Palestinians. That's why they were expelled, that's why their houses were demolished, that's why they were arrested, that's why they were killed, because they were Palestinians. And you say, I don't, as a normal good person, as a decent person, this kind of ideology looks to me bad, negative. What's the connection between condemning such an ideology and hating Jews? There is no connection whatsoever. I can tell you there are some Palestinians who are Zionists, and there are some Jews who are anti-Zionists, and there are some Christians who are Zionists, and there are some Christians who are anti-Zionists. Zionism is an ideological position. It's not a religious identity. If I condemn someone in South Africa for their apartheid position, and they happen to be Christian, it doesn't mean that I'm anti-Christian. It means that I'm anti-apartheid. And for some reason, we are not allowed to do it about Israel in this country and other countries. Because if we do it, we say, no, no, no. You see, you're anti-Semite. If you are against Zionism, you're against the Jewish people. I'm talking about legislation in the EU. I'm not inventing something. The EU equates in its new regulations anti-Zionism with anti-Semitism. How low and how stupid can be the people in Strasbourg? Either someone is paying them or someone is frightening them. I cannot accept that there are intelligent people who do it knowingly. I really cannot accept it. They are either terrified, which means they are anti-Semites. They think the Jews are so powerful that they don't dare to deal with it. So maybe they are anti-Semites. Or they are, someone is paying them. If you can give me another explanation why they do it, I would be very happy. I think about an MEP who gets a good salary and votes for such a definition. I want to hear from you a logical explanation why a normal member of the European Parliament would equate anti-Zionism with anti-Semitism. And I know that there are complex reasons that have to do with the Holocaust and so on. But I think that it's time for us to move forward with this kind of equations and put it aside. So what I ask you to do, which I'm sure many of you still do, is to understand from this book and many other works that what we need people here in Leuven and in Belgium, we don't need you to help us to talk to each other in Palestine. Don't bring Jews and Arabs to Leuven and tell them, here we'll help you, we are the progressive people. We'll help you to talk to each other, and we'll teach you how to dialogue with each other. So we don't need you for that. We need you, unfortunately, for only one thing. We need you to repeat the successful thing that Europe did in the fight against apartheid in South Africa. We need you to join the boycott, divestment, and sanction movement against Israel and send a message to Israel that its policies, its ideologies, its treatment of the Palestinian is unacceptable, and that there is a price tag attached to it. We really need a strong European movement that would send Israel a message that it's A, not in Europe, it's in the Arab world, and secondly, that its policies, its ideologies, and its attitudes are unacceptable, and that even if you are not politicians and you are not in a position of power, you have a way sending the Israeli strong message. And I want to congratulate your new management in this university that is willing to give up the horrendous agreement it had with Israel, security services and apparatus of developing together in Leuven all kinds of system to abuse human rights and humanity, you were wise enough to bring an end this shameful chapter in your university's history, and I'm very happy that your new rector, decided not to renew the agreement with the Israeli securitization sector. You need to do better things for humanity than to invent together with the Israelis methods of torture, arms that kill people, maim them, wound them, just because of their identity and nothing to do with what they are doing. So good for you for moving ahead, but we need much more than that. We need much more than that, and I think that as it worked in the case of South Africa, such a movement from Europe can have a very significant role to play in ending the suffering of the Palestinian that is more than 100 years old. Thank you.
The right terminology, beginning with settler colonialism,
I think we will understand that they also changed their understanding of what was on the ground.
Okay.
Good evening. Thank you very much. Maybe instead of, not instead, but next to, additional to this construction of the myths of the creation of Israel, it would be really good to hear from you also some kind of deconstruction of the myths that still people use a lot for going against the boycott. Many people, whenever you say it's so important to engage on the boycott, they immediately come up with so many arguments that this is exactly the most detrimental, it goes against the Palestinians, it goes against the Israeli citizens. So it would be good to hear from you the arguments to, what are the counter arguments?
Definitely, people are right to ask questions about boycott. It's not an easy decision to boycott. It's even more difficult for me to ask the world to boycott me, in a way. And that definitely, I think one, the first thing I would tell people, that the decision of people to support the idea of boycott came after they were hoping that something else would change the reality on the ground and bring an end to the Palestinian suffering. We all hoped that a diplomatic process would do the job. We all hoped that there would be change within the Israeli Jewish society, at least the beginning of a change that would tell us, okay, we can be hopeful, we can wait a little bit, but eventually this people would see the light. That's exactly that. Opposite happened. Israeli society is even more nationalist, even more anti-Palestinian, even more cruel in its policies towards the Palestinians than it was before. So I think that's the first thing I would tell people. Boycott was chosen as a method of trying to help to change the reality on the ground, because the other more attractive, if you want, more convenient methods failed. Secondly, I think boycott is a conversation. You don't ignore someone if you boycott them. You have a very unpleasant conversation with them. That's true. But you are doing it because what other non-violent way do you have to send Israelis a message that they are involved in an act of dehumanization? That they are involved in war crimes and crimes against humanity. Now, usually you rely on institutions such as the International Court of Justice in The Hague, such as the Criminal Court, such as the United Nations. You usually rely on states to say to a country that abuses human rights and civil rights that it will pay through a regime of sanctions. Many countries in the world were punished by sanctions. We know that Israel will not be punished by sanctions. So boycott is what a society does when its politicians and institutions fail to do what is morally right. So boycott is not only directed against Israel, it's also a message to the Belgian government that you are not doing what you should do in your foreign policy, and also as a member of the EU, towards the suffering of the Palestinians, which after all, they suffer because of anti-Semitism in Europe, because Europe did not know how to deal with its Jewish population, and through the Jewish population, all the Palestinians. So I think this is a very important message to people that they will be involved in a non-violent, hopefully constructive campaign that is not just directed against the Israelis, but is also directed to their politicians and so on. I think, finally, I know it's a long answer. Finally, I would say to people who are involved in boycott and the BDS, history will judge you in a very positive way. History will say thank you. You will be the people who were part of the beginning of a new reality in the ground. I think you should be very proud when you will tell your children and grandchildren that you were either in the anti-apartheid movement, where you're fighting against Pinochet in Chile, if you were fighting against the American involvement in Vietnam, if you fought in this country to remind people of the crimes Belgium committed in Congo, you will be people who will be at peace with themselves, and you have something very good to give to your next generation. So I think it's a very noble, decent act of humanity to be part of the Bundle Committee.
And you should not be short. You should be as long as humanly possible. It is your very good. Yes.
Good evening. So, 1 year ago, I attended one speech in Luxembourg, and I was with an Israeli friend, and at the end, he was, if not outraged, but still upset about what you said. He said that you didn't take into consideration the Israeli side. But my question is your voice heard in Israel, or is it just a dialogue between Europe and the Western world and Israel?
Yeah, a very good question. First of all, I'm sorry if I upset your friend. Usually when Israeli speakers say to me, I really feel unwell and upset after hearing you, and I always say to them, I saw a pharmacy on the way to the lecture hall. I'm sure it's still open, go and get something. Because your upset does not compare to the suffering of the Palestinians. So if I have to stop the suffering of the Palestinians by making you upset, for me it's not a high price. Secondly, more seriously about your question, I think there is something you have to realize. A settler colonial state or an apartheid state gives me, as a white person, as a Jewish person, privileges. And it's not very normal for a human being to voluntarily give up privileges. So if someone like me comes to my Israeli fellow patriots or compatriots and I say to them, we should give up most of the privileges that we have if we want to have peace and reconciliation, no wonder they're not particularly happy with either the message or the messenger. And I think this is a problem. This is really a big problem. So you can imagine that if there would be enough Israelis who believed in what I believe, we would have been in a different position. So the answer is not many Israelis share these views. On the other hand, it's very interesting what happened to me, and you mentioned the book Out of the Frame. When you have a chance to talk to the Israelis, and you have enough time to talk to them, they begin to have doubts. This is why I was expelled from the Israeli university, because I began to influence people, not only me. This is why there is a directive from the Minister of Education that I'm not allowed to speak in high schools. Why am I not allowed to speak in high school? They're afraid, and they're right, that Israeli kids are as intelligent as any other kid on the planet. And maybe when they will hear me, they will say, wait a minute, it can't be nice what he's saying. It sounds reasonable. We know. We live here. We can see it. So I'm optimistic. I think the main problem is the fact that Israel does not allow us to try and counter the indoctrination of the state. But I think once we will be able to do this, at least some of the population, not all of it, will change. As you know, apartheid South Africa did not fall because all the whites suddenly became anti-apartheid. In fact, the vast majority of whites in South Africa still believe in apartheid, the day apartheid fell. But now you go to South Africa, and everybody says to you, oh, I was against apartheid. So I say, all of you were against apartheid. Why did it last for so long? Right? So I can assure you, I can see it on my father-in-law, who's 8 years old. He's beginning to think that maybe I'm right, not because I'm right, but because I'm winning, in a way. So he begins to tell me, you know, I was against the war in Lebanon. And I said, no, you were not. No, I was. You didn't understand me. I was against the annexation of Jerusalem. children in the debate. He said, no, you misunderstood me. I think the similar kind of mechanism could work also in Israel once we succeed in with the pressure from the outside. So yes, it's not the main target. My main target now is not to convince the Israeli Jewish society that they are wrong. My main target is to convince the world that Israel is wrong and to hope that the Palestinians will get their act together and seize this very unique historical moment to have a proper liberation movement, which they don't have, and a proper vision for the future, which they don't have. Tell the Jews in Israel, how do they see them in a future vision? I think the Palestinians also have a very important agency in making it possible. If the international community and the Palestinians would have a clear idea of how to move forward, I think a lot of Israelis would go with it. But because there's also vagueness on the Palestinian side, and there is a carte blanche from the world, I see it's very difficult to see what should motivate the Israelis to give up the privileges or change the racist attitudes towards the Palestinians.
Okay, thank you very much for this very intelligent and sharp question. So I'm Abed Kitana, I'm from Palestine. And if we are talking about the European front, I would like you to ask, in addition to the boycott and the BDS, don't you think that also Europeans have to work to support, defend, or legitimize the right to resistance? And how do we have the right to resist the Israeli colonial system? So far in Europe, I really still hesitant all the time to look that my brother is a resistant member, because I think people will look weird to me. So I think also this thing must be somehow highlighted.
Yeah.
And in terms of resistance, what do you think about the different types of resistance that Palestinians might use? Which one do you think is more legitimate than the other?
First of all, I think the right to resist is enshrined in the international law. People have the right to resist, including without resistance, to occupation, according to the United Nations Charter. So the question is not so much, I think, whether it's a legitimate thing for an occupied, colonized people to resist. There's some resistance that you talked about. Of course it's legitimate. But you're absolutely right that the second question is even more important. What kind of resistance is the right one? Now, of course, nobody should tell the Palestinians how to resist. It's an agency of the Palestinians. But we can, as historians, if you want, as academics, lend our voice to our assessment of what happened in Palestine in the last 70 years. And I'll give you an example. After the Arab Spring, after 2011, especially after what happened in Egypt, in Maidan al-Tahrir, the young generation of Palestinians inside Israel wanted to go and do something similar inside Israel. And we talked to them and we said, you're absolutely right, and you have the right to do it. But it would be suicidal. The Israelis would kill all of you. We don't want that. We said that there is no point in doing it. It will not change the reality. Hundreds of you would be dead, and you would not do anything for the liberation of Palestine. I think in the 21st century, and we can see it on the Gaza border, and we saw it in Jerusalem in the demonstrations against Al-Aqsa, I think that in the 21st century, a popular resistance, both non-violent and active, is far better than armed resistance in getting results. The main reason I'm saying it is that I know from the Israeli perspective, they like it when the Palestinians do armed resistance. It gives them a pretext to use their army to do horrific things to the Palestinians. And the imbalance of power, the military imbalance of power is such that any armed resistance by the Palestinians would be answered by horrific war crimes by the Israelis. I don't see the point in it. I don't see what is the benefit? Of course, if you want to be a Shaheed and you believe that this is the way Leven, that's something else. This is not my place, and I respect that people think that this is the place. But if you don't do it for that reason, you are not going to change the reality on the ground, and you will make many more Palestinians suffer. So I think I don't envy anyone who has to strategize the Palestinian resistance. I think the young people, those of you who know what happened in Gaza, know that it was not the Hamas that organized the beginning of the demonstration. It was the young people of Gaza who said, enough, we don't care. We go to the fence and we cross the fence because our parents and grandparents come from the lands which are on the other side of the fence, and at the same time we protest against the blockade, the siege. The Hamas wisely said, okay, come on, if we're not going to resist you, but let us help you with the structure and so on. This is a non-violent demonstration. Now, I know the results are horrific, and nobody should advise other people to sacrifice themselves in front of a military that is inhuman and barbarous like the Israeli army. But unfortunately, I don't see any other way of reenacting in a way the First Intifada and finding a way of moving through this kind of resistance. But I think you always have to do it with international support. As you know, unfortunately, we cannot expect any help from the Arab world, which is horrible, which is really something which was not there before. So it's either the international community would help with this kind of resistance, or we will wait until we can do it even better. But I think that definitely this is a tactical question that should, I agree with you, should totally be separated from the question of legitimacy. You know, I can say to you it's legitimate to you to do A, B, and C. I can tell you my opinion that A is not a good idea, but I don't say it's not a legitimate idea, but it may not be a good idea. And I think, and you're absolutely right, I think you won't be able to have that constructive dialogue with Palestinians if you start by saying to them, first of all, your resistance is not legitimate. If you say the resistance is legitimate, maybe they would be willing to listen to advice from all kinds of people. Maybe people who were involved in resistance elsewhere, maybe people who are analyzing the results and so on. Never underestimate the Israeli idea of militarism. The Israeli army didn't have a proper war for many, many years. And it needs exercise for its soldiers. And it wants, really, it wants a war in Gaza. And it wants a war with Hezbollah. They need to feel, to show the society that they are active, that they are powerful, and so on. We should not give them the pretext for another Nakba. They have the moral will and the capacity to do another Nakba. I don't want to give them the excuse. And I want to ask the international community to understand that the lunatics of the Arab world are not sitting in Tehran. They sit in Tel Aviv and Jerusalem. And that the world should help us to restrain them and contain them instead of talking about them as the only democracy in the world.
So I want to refer to your analysis of ignorance with diplomats, with ministers, etc. I do agree with the point you made at the end that it's about the money that they are bought, which brings us who has interest to bribe people for this to defend this position in the region. And I think that's a blank in what you told this evening. I'm sure you can elaborate a little bit on that. Is the role of Israel in the region, the economical interests that are there in the region, and why for that so much support is continuously going towards the Israeli position. Everybody knows if the United States would withdraw support, Israel would quickly be isolated. So there is another interest than just killing Palestinians. That brings me to the second point I want to ask you to elaborate on a little bit. When talking about the region, you refer to human rights, and that we should work more on human rights and then can be involved in the region. It's just the same powers that are paying the money who use human rights to violate one of the basic principles of the United Nations Charters, which is the sovereignty of the country and the non-interference. I don't understand why you link the two to each other. One on the one side, the ones who pay the money, you criticize, while on the other hand, you use human rights, which is also used by the same people to interfere. Can you clarify that a little bit?
First of all, the strategic alliances and so on. I think, of course, Israel has good allies and alliances on economic basis with China, India, Europe, and America. It's not only America. This brings a philosophical question. We are all, I think, entangled with since 2008, probably since the beginning of modernity, but particularly since 2008. Do we want to inject morality, moral issues into policies? If we don't, we accept neoliberalism as a system which says what matters is the profit. You make a profit, whatever the price is. If the price is to destroy a factory, a community that lives around the factory, if the price is to allow colonialism, oppression, it doesn't matter because you will make an extra billion because of that new alliance. This is a cynical world, and fighting against it in the case of Palestine is not exceptional. Palestine is just happened to be in the eyes of many people, and this is why I say we have a special opportunity about Palestine. Palestine is identified today by many people with injustice, social injustice. And therefore you can see, for instance, people who are involved in industrial action, in strikes, and social struggle, even in America, putting on themselves the Palestinian flag. Not because the Palestine has anything to do with their conditions of work, because the flag symbolizes injustice and the fight for justice. It used to be a different flag before that, but today Palestine is a symbolism of the world, not even of the worst kind of injustice, but the most cynical, more sinister kind of injustice. So I think we cannot find the neoliberal alliances based on money and strategic interests by singling out the connection with Israel. We need to decide whether we can create, either in our own places or in wider context, what the young generation calls justice and what the older generation calls naivety. I think it's not naive. The 2008 movement was not successful, but it did show very clearly that the younger people don't want to give up the idea that politics can have a moral basis. And all the people said to them, oh, come on, even with the age of 30, you would understand that politics and morality have nothing to do with each other. So it depends on what kind of world we can live. Either we succeed in doing a case study that interests us, or we can be part of a more global movement. I didn't fully understand your second point, I must say, but I try. I didn't put sovereignty against human rights. I don't think that the two are mutually exclusive. I pointed to the fact that the main problem, I didn't say the only problem, the main problem in Syria is not the intervention of the outside. Yes, that's a problem, I agree. But the main problem is the total disregard for human life. And I think you have to begin with humanity before you start with political structures and states and sovereignty. They are important, I agree. This is particularly important in the case of Palestine, because the peace process in Palestine convinced few Palestinians, especially in the occupied West Bank, that sovereignty is more important than the Palestinian rights. That led to Palestinian leaders giving up on the right of return. If not officially, then informally. Oslo was a Palestinian signature saying Palestine is only the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, and the Palestinians are only the people who live in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. That's what happens if you deal with sovereignty and independence. But if you dealt with the Palestinian issue as a human rights and civil rights, it would have included all of Palestine and all the Palestinians. The right of return, to my mind, the right of return of the Palestinians is far more important than having a Bantustan in Ramallah. But it's up to the Palestinians, of course, to decide. I'm not a Palestinian, I'm not going to determine the agenda, but it's very clear for me that human rights and civil rights in places of colonialism, oppression, massacres, the kind of inhumanity we have seen in the rest of the Arab world, the best way to fight against it is to come back and respect these rights as an essential part of life. Other issues are important, institutions, sovereignty, legitimacy, the rule of law. I don't underestimate their importance. But I begin with life, life itself. It became very cheap in the Arab world, and it's very cheap in Palestine. I want to make human life, again, very expensive. Expensive in the positive.
How is it possible that in the national there is no reaction almost against the fact that children are judged and going to prison, and that they make new settlements continuously, and there is almost no reaction or no reaction whatsoever in the country? How is that possible?
I'll tell you how it's possible. The peace process, it's an interesting case, the so-called peace process. You have to look at the origins of it. I'm talking especially on the peace process after 1967. It was prepared by American academics and American politicians. They're the ones who built the infrastructure for the peace process. As you know, in America, there's a very good connection between the academia and policy makers. And they consulted mainly the Israelis. They were not even interested in talking to the Palestinians. They decided that what matters in a peace process is the balance of power. There's a strong party and a weak party. You don't have to talk to the weak party. This is also what Fafo believed in, the Norwegian organization that did Oslo. You don't have to talk to the weak party. Your role as a mediator is to convince the weak party to get the best that you can get out of the strong party. Okay? So the Israeli, very cleverly in many ways, the Israeli so-called peace camp said to the Americans, here is what we offer. We know that we, unfortunately, as they say, we have to abuse the rights of the Palestinians. And yes, new settlements are still being built, children are being sent to prison. However, you have to understand, and that's what you have to tell the Palestinians, that when there will be peace, and they will recognize Israel as a Jewish state, then all these abuses will stop. This is like saying to anyone who's responsible for abuses of human rights in Syria today, we accept that you will continue to abuse human rights, namely to kill innocent people, because we know that once there will be a political settlement for Syria, these atrocities will end. Nobody's offering such a moral position. People say, no, you have to, first of all, you have to stop the abuses of human rights, then you can talk about a political settlement. You cannot, it's not logical. But in the case of Israel, it became logical. It became logical to accept this Israeli view that says, whatever we're doing now to the Palestinians, it's temporary, and it will stop once there will be peace. The great thing that we have to do to convince those who are interested in peace in Palestine and Israel, in Europe, in America, and elsewhere, that is to have the reverse, to put this on its head and say, no, first of all, stop the abuses of the Palestinian rights. And then we can talk about peace. Not the other way around. And I think that was the power of the BDS movement. The BDS movement had a very simple message. It said, we boycott and divest and hopefully convince governments to sanction Israel, because if it does not at least respect three basic rights. They didn't say we boycott Israel until there is a political settlement, until there is a one-state solution, until there is a two-state solution. No, the BDS movement says Israel continuously abuses three basic rights, and as long as it abuses these basic rights, we will continue the BDS movement. One right is the right of the Palestinians in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip not to be ruled by the power of the Israeli military. The second right is the right of the Palestinian refugees to return. The third right is the right of the Palestinians who are citizens of Israel not to live under an apartheid system that Israel has legitimized and legalized. And I think this is why this, it looks logic to people when Israeli says, you know, unfortunately, we have to continue to arrest children because the Palestinians resist and there's no peace. Yes, you're right. We have to say to them, wait a minute, I want to unpack your sentence. Your sentence doesn't make any sense. You stop arresting children. Doesn't matter what. You don't arrest children. Doesn't matter what happens. You don't arrest children. You don't demolish homes of people. But it's amazing how the world is silent about these crimes and accept this formula that these are necessary crimes, temporary crimes before peace. We have to change, as we talked with the gentleman there, we have to change the language. We have to change the language when we talk about Palestine and Israel and not use the language of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the EU or the language of the mainstream media in this country or in any other Western country. We should teach them to use a different language.
Hi. My name is Ilana. I'm American, Belgian, and Jewish. I'm very grateful for your work. Thank you. You've alluded to a vision. You talked about deferring to others for their vision, which I appreciate. But I'd love to hear your vision.
I analyze the fact that we don't have a clear vision by me, by which I meant, I didn't mean that Palestinians, certain Palestinians don't have a vision. I said that Palestinian institutions don't have a vision, and that's a problem for us in the solidarity movement with the Palestinians and among the anti-Zionist Israelis who are looking to help the Palestinians. It's, we don't have the luxury that people have at the time of the ANC, when the ANC had a clear vision and we knew exactly what we were fighting for. Yes, I have a vision and I am part of the group of Palestinians and Israelis who work on the ground for the idea of a one-state solution. We believe in one democratic state for all that would also have mechanism to correct the injustices of the past. The most important of them is the expulsion of the Palestinians, so we are looking for mechanisms that would enable the right of return to be implemented. And we hope that one day the Palestinian national movement, its institution, would adopt this idea. They used to have this idea until 1968. They gave it up after 1982 because of what happened in Lebanon. And I think that this is a very positive vision. It really says, A, Palestinians deserve to have normal life, like everyone else. It doesn't beautify the Palestinians. It doesn't turn them into particularly amazing people. It turns them into normal people, which is never allowed them to be. So it demands normality for the Palestinians. It offers the Jews who live today in Israel the biggest Palestinian concession, which is that the Jews can stay in Israel and Palestine, whatever to them the state will be called. There is no Palestinian demand that Palestinians should, that Israelis, the Israeli Jews should leave. There is a demand for a political system that is democratic for all. And I think that this is not a totally lunatic vision. It's a very normal vision to ask that people in Palestine and Israel would have the kind of political life, a normal life, with all the divisions and arguments and misunderstanding and debates that other people have. I think only people who visited Palestine know what I'm talking about. Really, I can talk here for 5 hours. I can show you 55 films. You just need to be one day to see a checkpoint and to understand what does it mean to live in a place where a soldier can decide whether you can reach your university, where you can open your shop, where you can leave your home, whether you can have a home, whether you can be in prison or not. And every soldier can decide on the spot, according to his mood, what he does with you, whether you are a pregnant mother, a baby, or an old person. And I don't think people believe it until they see it with their own eyes. And you see it, there's no way of, Israel doesn't even try to hide it. So I think you have to see this and then come back very angry, that this inhumanity is being paid by the United States, by the EU, by Belgium, by your country, you pay for it as well, and you give international legitimacy to that, and you don't do anything against it. I would be very unhappy if my government would be part of such inhumanity.
I don't have a very insightful question like the others. I think most probably because many of the facts are innate to me. We, as a Palestinian, I'm breastfed this information. But what I would like to ask is, as a Palestinian refugee, what are the most points that I can advocate for my people? Because I've never been to Palestine. I am not allowed. I don't have the right to return to Palestine. But what ways can I really advocate, the strongest I can advocate for my case? And most importantly, even if subconsciously, what things youth, Palestinian refugee youth, do to actually harm our cause in the media and in the Western world? Thank you.
Thank you. I think particularly nowadays with what is called the refugee crisis in Europe, it's very important to explain to people that Palestinian refugees want to go home. They want to return. They don't want to stay in Europe. They want to return to Palestine. And I think that one of the best, not the only one, I think one of the most important part of the problem that happened in Syria and in Iraq to a certain extent and is connected to Palestinian refugees and was totally ignored by the international media and is one a very strong case for Palestinian refugees. That all the countries that were neighbors of Syria, all the countries neighboring Syria, received the refugees in great numbers. And these, not all of them are rich countries, and they have their own problems, as you know, Lebanon, Jordan, Turkey, Iraq. But they received refugees. The country which is the richest and has a border with Syria and did not receive one refugee is Israel. Now, this is particularly bizarre because many of the Palestinian refugees, at least, of, among the Syrian refugees, have brothers, sisters, cousins in Israel who were willing to do all the refugee, to treat these refugees on their own account. The state didn't even have to spend $1. They all told that they told the Israelis, you know, these are my cousins, these are my sisters, these are my brothers. Let them come back to where anyway they are from. And let's use this horrific human tragedy to create something better, which is a kind of healing by allowing people to come back to where they were expelled from. Of course, I'm not naive. I knew that Israel would never accept it. But I don't understand why I have to accept that also people who are not Israelis would accept this as well. Why someone here would say to me the same thing as Israeli, oh come on, this is not reasonable. Why are you saying, I know why the Israelis are saying it's not reasonable. It has to do with the nature, the racist nature of this new state. They need to be majority. But why are you in Brussels telling me that it doesn't stand to reason that families of Palestinian families would be reunited with their families in the Galilee as part of the cheapest, most fast and reasonable solution for the tragedy that occurred in Syria, at least for the Palestinian refugees. So this is the kind of conversation I think we have to have with people, to show them that when they repeat the Israeli propaganda, the myths, as I call them, they say unreasonable thing about what can be done on the ground. And partly, and secondly, I think we all could continue to tell people, even if they heard it from the 100th time, that there, according to the United Nations Resolution 194, and according to the international law, every Palestinian refugee has the right to return. And not allowing them to return is a violation of the international law. And only the refugees can decide not to return, not someone who speaks in their name. I think this is a very important issue because it goes to the heart of the nature of the Jewish state. You can hear Europeans tell you, come on, you want millions of Palestinians to come back, then the Israelis will not be a majority. And you say, yes, this is a racist idea, that what you say that the only way Israel can exist is if it's a Jewish majority. That means you allow the Israelis to do all they can to make sure that they remain a majority, from killing people to expelling them to not allowing them to return. And as we know, in 2018, Israel controls the whole of Palestine, and the Jews are not a majority there anyway. Now the Palestinians are more than the Jews, and it doesn't disturb the Israeli democracy because it's not a democracy. So I think that we should connect the things together, and hopefully it will open up the eyes of people who are decent, even with the modicum of decency. I don't think they can really reject our humanity and our approach for this particular aspect of the religion.
For the right of the Palestinians, so she deserves warm applause.